The premier honor in literature, the Nobel Prize, was awarded Thursday to Mexican author Octavio Paz. Paz had reportedly been in the running for many years, and the Nobel Academy cited some of his work from 30 years ago in making its decision. Paz is known for his poetry and his essays. His best-known book is entitled The Labyrinth of Solitude. In awarding the prize, the Swedish Academy of Letters praised Paz for impassioned writing with wide horizons characterized by sensuous intelligence and humanistic integrity. Paz was in New York when he got the news.
Well, I was sleeping peacefully when this morning, very early in the morning, I had a telephone call and with the news. And I was surprised because I didn't expect the prize. And 2 years ago, a year ago also, I was candidate. I knew that I was candidate because and I was in some way waiting the news with some anxiety, with some skepticism also. But this time, no, it was, I didn't have the slight idea that I could have the prize. And it was a doubly surprise and doubly pleasant, because surprise that you don't expect are much more pleasant that surprise that you are expecting.
Joining us now to look at the life and work of Octavio Paz is Martha Paley Francescato. She's a professor of Spanish culture and literature at George Mason University near Washington. Thank you for joining us. Octavio Paz, 76 years old, former diplomat, which sort of suggests an elite upbringing, kind of a high cultural tone. Tell us about this man. Who is Octavio Paz?
Octavio Paz actually is, I would say, the best writer nowadays in Mexico and in Latin America. I think that the Nobel Committee finally did what it should have done years ago, which is honor a Latin American writer. Because since García Márquez, we haven't had any Nobel awards in Latin America, and we deserve them. I may sound too biased, but that's the case.
The market, the readership for García Márquez is obviously global. What about Octavio Paz? Is he read wherever Hispanic literature is read?
Yes, yes, definitely, because you mentioned The Labyrinth of Solitude, and it's true. It's a very basic, very crucial book to read to understand the Mexicans, but it's not only about Mexicans, but about Latin Americans in general, because you can apply what he says to most Latin Americans.
He talks about solitude and a sense of loneliness,
yes.
not just sort of self-possession, but I guess exclusion as well. What is his interpretation of Mexico, and how does this solitariness fit into it?
Okay, what he says basically, and of course it would take me years to discuss everything, so I'll summarize it, is that the Mexican person is basically lonely. That the human being, I would say, is basically lonely. But in spite of all this, there is hope, and the hope lies in love with other people, in the couple being each person being lonely, finally meet each other, they're no longer lonely. So I would say that loneliness leads to friendship, so it's not complete loneliness. Two lonely people meet each other, and they are together, and that is the end of loneliness.
The famous witticism about Mexico has an element of solitude and loneliness in it, so far from God,
yes, and
so close to the
United States.
Does that tension inform Paz's work? Is he always seeing Uncle Sam looming over his shoulder?
No, not Octavio Paz, no. Other writers do, but Octavio Paz has a very strong Oriental influence too, because when he was ambassador, you know, and he does compare, of course, Mexico and the United States. That's, of course,
inescapable, I think.
Yeah, definitely. You have to, as you said, they're so close to God, so close to the United States. and there are distant neighbors. That's another thing, you know, that people have to remember. Because what most Mexicans do is try to explain themselves in order to cross the bridge between the two cultures, which are so different and yet have so many things in common.
As I say, Paz has a diplomatic background, a high cultural background. He would, I guess, be considered part of the natural aristocracy of Mexico. But how does he relate to the Mexican masses? Do they read him?
Yes, I wouldn't say that the Mexicans wouldn't accept the idea of a Mexican aristocracy, but his poetry is very accessible. Some of it, of course, not all, but people do read him. And he also has a journal, which has been going on forever, and people do read him.
You have a poem picked out to read us of his. Why don't you do so now?
Okay, it's a very short poem, but I think it embodies many of his ideas. It's called Village. The stones are time, the wind, centuries of wind. The trees are time, the people are stone. The wind turns upon itself and sinks into the stone day. There is no water here for all the luster of its eyes. That's it.
There's a compactness there, and there's also a sort of almost colloquial, non-aristocratic diction. Reminds me a little bit of the American Imagistes. William Carlos Williams comes to mind.
Yeah, and I think this poem also shows that he's close to the people, because he's talking about a village and talking about the stones and time and wind, which are the same in this village and in other villages. And again, in Mexico, it's very important, the idea of stones, of the, he has a poem called Piedra de Sol, the stone, the calendar, the Aztec calendar, which was a round stone, okay, and time, because time is very important, the perception of time the Mexicans have, which is different from the perception of time in other places, especially in the United States. And the presence of the past, that is a very, very important theme in all of Mexican literature, and Paz exemplifies it very, very well.
We'll talk a little bit more about Nobel Prize winner Octavio Paz in just a moment on CBS News Nightwatch. Hispanic letters. What's the impact going to be of this ultimate international recognition for Octavio Paz?
Well, I think people are going to be very, very happy about it, because it was long overdue. Octavio Paz deserves the Nobel Prize, and I think even a writer like Carlos Fuentes recently said, he's also in the running, you know, for the Nobel Prize, but he said, if they give it to someone, it has to be to Octavio Paz. So people agree to that.
Octavio Paz started out as something of a leftist, but he now has come to a very critical position. I think he said that sort of the most rigid, least curious intellectuals in the world are leftist intellectuals of Latin America. A lot of those people are angry at him because he rejected the Sandinistas pretty early on.
Yeah, okay, let me tell you something. I wouldn't believe in everything a writer says about politics, because they like to have certain postures. And most Latin American writers feel they have to be leftists, and in a way it is logical. Intellectuals in general like to be considered leftists. Octavio Paz started as a leftist, well, so did Borges, and then they go to the right. So nowadays, I know, I think the disappointment with the Cuban Revolution has a lot to do with that, because at the beginning everyone was for it, and then people became disenchanted with it. And Octavio Paz may feel the same way. And also with the political system in Mexico, you know, the PRI and the continuation of the same party and no room for other parties, although this may change shortly.
Seems to have changed considerably in the last election. I've heard it suggested that there are two Octavio Pazes, the prose Paz and the poetry Paz.
Yes.
What are the distinctions?
Well, in his prose, of course, you see he hasn't written novels or short stories, basically essays. So they tend to be more cerebral. And his poetry, however, is also cerebral, but it's more spontaneous, as any poetry is, so it's more, shows more of his emotions.
The Nobel Committee talks about a sensuousness in his prose. what sort of subjects does he address in that sensuous tone?
Well, I would say that the sensuousness can be found more in his poetry than in his prose. Again, the idea of love, of the couple, of woman. He's very interested recently in women. He has written a very, very important book on Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz, who was a Mexican writer of the 17th century. So he has written a very, very huge, very long book on her.
And in the somewhat macho world of Hispanic letters, I guess this is something of a breakthrough for a most serious male writer to pay serious attention to women.
Well, again, I think the macho world is another fabrication. It is changing a lot, and I wouldn't say there is no such thing, but intellectuals try to at least give the impression that they are leftist and that they are not macho. So whether it's true or not, we'll have to let the people, the readers, decide.
Are there younger versions of Paz in Mexican or elsewhere in Hispanic letters? Are there people of our generation who are speaking in Paz-influenced tones?
Everyone does, but I would cite the Mexican writer José Emilio Pacheco, who is here now and teaching at a university, and he is a great admirer of Paz. And also, if you are an admirer of someone, you tend to be influenced, whether you know it or not. Some people don't want to declare influences, you know, but they are influenced.
Well, I would guess that the recognition of the Nobel Committee should be cause for great celebration.
Yes.
Throughout the Hispanic
Yes.
world, and especially Yeah. in the Hispanic literary world.
Yeah. We're celebrating today at the university, my students, the faculty, everyone is.
Well, Martha Paley, Francescato, thank you very much for joining us for this discussion of today's Nobel Prize winner for literature, the poet and essayist Octavio Paz of Mexico. Our CBS News Night Watch continues in just a moment. Don't go away.